work out ever. You are in so good shape, girl. You are awesome. Honey, you made me throw in those punches. I just can't believe it. I had my doubts, but you know what? Where are you? Coaches? Hold up, you're attacking me now. Hold on. I'm sorry, my arm. Let's get you up. What is...
Yeah. Oh, God. Okay.
You're all right. Take a slow breath. How about a slow breath here?
Okay.
Now grab my arm.
Yeah.
And I'll help you up. I'm good.
Okay.
Can you put that bottle down?
Down. Would you just please help me up?
Around and had you read them over, I don't know, 2,000 times, but you know what? I can tell it's time we're going to read them again. Come on, look at me here. Listen, 1 Timothy 6:12, fight the good fight of faith. Yeah. 2 Timothy 4:7, yeah. Paul says, yeah. I have fought a good fight of faith. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith.
I got a feeling I'm going to do all my courses tomorrow.
That's doubt. That's doubt. Look right here. Look here. Romans 8:35-36. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long.
Wait. You said killed?
Let me finish.
That's what I'm afraid's gonna happen to me tomorrow.
Look, keep reading here. Yet in all these things we are more than conqueror through Him that loved us. You have taken your eyes off Jesus, and doubt is gripping you. Listen to this again. Listen, you are more than a conqueror.
I am a conqueror!
That's right. That's right. You are. Now, let's seal this with a prayer, okay?
Yeah.
Lord, your word says that we are more than a conqueror through Christ. Father, we just claim that promise in your word right now. Lord, I claim that for my friend. Lord, please remove all doubt. Help her to fight a good fight of faith. And Lord, we just pray victory for her over her enemies. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Can we go to the conference now? Look, you need to take a shower and clean up. Now, come on. Watch your step. Let's get to the conference. You always run me late. Every year you run me late.
Are you saying that? Is that what you're saying?
I'm not saying that.
Oh, y'all need to give him one more hand. Conference. This is our 11th conference. We do this every November, and Delma and Cochise are our ongoing characters, and characters they are. So we always have a great time, and matter of fact, tomorrow they're going to continue this big fight, so you definitely don't want to miss it. But we're so glad you're here tonight. This is a great crowd, and I just feel something good's about to happen. I feel the excitement in this place. I'm excited. My husband's even got on an orange shirt. I'm so excited. This is a woman's conference, but you might see a few guys were around, and they're just servants tonight. And isn't that awesome that they're here? And I'm just going to make a few announcements and we'll welcome in prayer and everything. But I do want to tell you that we do have some beautiful t-shirts and we do have some. Debbie, we have a few left, huh? We got some t-shirts at $13, so be sure and pick one of those up. And aren't the decorations beautiful this year? We love this color. We're so excited about pink and orange. Bobby said pink and orange, really. Well, it works, doesn't it? So, but we're glad you're here. If this is your first time, in fact, if this is your first time at a River of Life Women's Conference, lift your hand. Let me see how many first time. Look at all these first timers. The reason I know we're going to have a good time tonight because we have been fighting tooth and nail to get to this point without a hitch. And I'm going to tell you what, God is going to be the victor tonight. Yeah. We're not going to be defeated. We've had sound issues as usual. And we had no problems, Brother Dwayne, practicing or anything. God bless you. We turned on the sound for this evening and we have problems. But Manny, God bless him. He's been working and everybody else. And so the band is here. We're excited. It's going to be a good night. I want to introduce to you the pastor of River of Life. So I'm going to get my very handsome husband to come up in his orange shirt and welcome you.
I'm not so sure if it's a shirt or a blouse.
A blouse, you're in the right place.
Yeah, that's my word tonight. I wanted to blend in a little bit. So, of course, I'm the only one with this haircut here tonight. I know you're jealous, to be honest. But I join my welcome with Lolly. We welcome you. Thanks for coming tonight. We welcome any who might be watching now. River of Life, every service we're broadcasting live over the World Wide Web. So those who maybe couldn't make it to the sanctuary are watching now through the internet. So we welcome them as well. This is not just an event on our calendar. This is one of the most important events on the yearly calendar of the River of Life. This is something that's much prayed over, much worked for, much... most importantly, prayed over. And so we believe that every year God is moving us to a higher level. And this year is going to be the greatest conference. Now, what'd you say, 11 years? Well, I just started 15 years of pastoring here, so these years go by fast. But I believe the best is yet to come. I know we've had some wonderful things in the past. But Jesus is still on the throne, and today he's one day closer to coming for his bride. And so I believe with anticipation that God is going to do a great work. In these last days, he's pouring out that latter rain. And I hope tonight that you're ready for that, that you've come believing and expecting, not just for you, but that the Lord would saturate this place with his anointing. Because it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. It's through the anointing of Jesus Christ that we can move from the natural realm into the supernatural realm where all things, let me just say this real loud and proud to be a Christian tonight, because of the anointing, all things are possible. There is nothing too difficult for God. And so we're going to be believing as we continue to pray, as we pray and open this altar a little later tonight, that you'll get a breakthrough, that you'll get a miracle in your life, whatever there is a lack in your life. Salvation includes everything. Salvation, the Greek word, it's sozo. It means wholeness. He came, he lived, he died for wholeness. That we have lack in our life, it is not the will of God. He came to seek and to sozo, make whole. Everybody. So we're going to pray that wholeness is coming tonight. And I know that we're going to press in and intercede. Some of you have children and you have neighbors and friends and other family members that need a miracle, that need a touch from God. Maybe they don't even know the Lord. And so I pray you'll come as an intercessor. We'll set our faith in agreement and we're going to believe that God is going to bind the devil. He's going to set the captive free. He's going to pour out miracles. Can we get together in agreement tonight? Let's set our faith in agreement. If you believe the word of God, just give me a good shout. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah. Well, I'm going to ask you to stand and let's just make this beginning, this call of worship, the beginning of this 2012 conference, let's just bathe it with prayer. Because we have not, because we ask not. So I pray that you'll make your requests known right now. Tell the Lord what you need. Tell him what you want. Tell him where your lack is tonight. And then by faith, reach up and pull it on down. Lord, we know who you are. You've revealed yourself in your word. You've revealed yourself in the Holy Spirit. You've revealed yourself, and every time I turn around, I see you, Lord. And you're wonderful. We love you, Lord. We bless you tonight. We praise you tonight. I thank you for my wife, my helpmate, and for the vision and for the leadership that she gives to women's ministry and all those who called around that purpose and that vision and have worked so hard and sacrificed so much to make this weekend possible. So we believe, Lord, for everything we've asked, we've heard, and you're going to answer. And we anticipate with a spirit of expectancy. Great things are about to happen as we stand on holy ground and we move by faith. We declare tonight, victory is ours in Jesus Christ. Bless these ladies now, Lord, with a supernatural outpouring, a supernatural anointing right now. Take us to another level. Let us see things we've never seen, Lord Jesus. And may you get all the glory. May all flesh fall before you tonight as you are exalted high above all tonight. We give you all our praise, all our worship, and all our love. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You can just leave it there. Are you ready to worship tonight? Well, let me just say before we start, before the band kicks it off on the first note, because the first song is a jumping up and down song. Now, if you never jumped up and down for the Lord, that's okay. Now, don't look at your neighbor and say, wow, they're jumping up and down. Just say, well, praise the Lord. Now, if they're lifting their hand and you've never lifted your hands, don't look at your neighbor and say, what are they doing lifting their hands? You know what? Just worship the Lord tonight in freedom. Because the Word says he who the Son sets free, he is free indeed. And you know what? There's freedom in this house tonight. There's freedom to love the Lord. Hey, we're in church, aren't we? Isn't that what we do in church? Is love on Jesus? So you know what? You be free. No matter what you do, no matter how you worship, if you worship inside and you don't have to do outward, that's okay too. We're not going to look at you funny. But listen, if you get a little move going, that's all right too. Just spread out. And let's just worship the Lord. Robert's going to kick it off with a song called Freedom. Yeah. got no more shackles. Listen, when at River of Life, when we do that, we let the, if you didn't know what this meant, we're letting off those chains. You know, because some of you, you've come in here and you got some chains you got to let go of. Some of pressures that you've been through today. Some of you had a hard day at work, or maybe you've been stuck in traffic and you kind of lost your religion or whatever. So you need to come in, you need to let it go, because you know what? God wants to do a work in this house, and the only way he's going to do it if we let go of those things that are binding us up. If the healing is going to begin tonight in this place, we got to start by getting free. And look, I know this isn't really doing it, but doesn't it make you feel good to do it? Just let it go. Just let it go.
No more shades, no more blind desires. Sing it out.
No more shackles, no more chains, no more blind desires. Free.
No more shackles, no more chains, no more blind desires.
Are you ready?
some nuns up here. That's all we needed, and we could have really, Brother Dwayne, that's all we needed. But, well, kind of felt like that. Praise the Lord. I'm sorry. So you know what? God really wants to do something in this healing conference. And some of you maybe you've got the wrong impression. Maybe you believe that, you know, we're going to have this great power to lay hands on everybody in here and they all walk out of here physically healed. But it's not just about that. It's about Jesus being the healer. See, he's the healer that wants to heal you mind, body, soul, and spirit. He's the healer that wants to walk down these aisles and in these rows and touch each one of you in a way that only he can. And he's ready. And I hope you're ready tonight for the healer. Amen.
God, we thank you tonight that you are the healer, God. That you are in the house, Father. And we ask that your presence would come right now, God. And that you would heal us, God. That you would heal our families. That you would heal our lives, God. We thank you that nothing is impossible for you, God. That nothing that seems impossible to us is impossible to you, God. And we thank you.
Impossible.
So a lot of things were going on, and physically I was going through some things, you know, a normal thing when you get my age, you know, women, we go through these changes. And all of a sudden, you know, otherwise I'm just healthy, always healthy and real energetic, and then all of a sudden I'm losing it. I'm all of a sudden my body starts. I remember calling mom, you know, every day, Mom, I'm dying. I know I'm dying. It's done. I'm dying. I know I have something horrible going on in my body. I don't know what it is yet. So I went to the cardiologist. I went to the doctor. I had all these tests run, the gallbladder, checked everything, and they kept saying, And mom kept saying, just go to your, you know, GYN. And I couldn't get an appointment with her, so before I could get her, I had to go see all these other doctors. And they, you know, men, they don't understand. Sorry, guys, they're still in here. They don't really understand hormones, do they?
No.
And they shouldn't even try, and don't even ask them. Because I told them, okay, I'm having a pain here, my heart's fluttering, I'm having headaches, I'm really tired, I'm having hot flashes, and he's just looking at me. Like, so what's your point? You know? And so then I go to the cardiologist and I tell him, I think I must have some vein problems. I'm surely I have, you know, some kind of blockage. He said, no, there's nothing wrong with you. And it was like, nurse, next patient. I mean, there's nothing wrong with her. Get her out of here. So I finally go to my GYN, and she does a little blood test, and you know, mom's always right.
Yeah.
She says, yes, you're going through the change. Here, take these little pills every day. You'll be fine. Funny thing happened. I took those little pills, and within a week, I'm back to old Lolly. You know, I'm feeling good. No gallstone problems. I didn't have gallstones to begin with, but I thought I did. No heart fluttering anymore. No restless. No hot flashes. Oh, my gracious. The hot flashes were like, I was getting like 90 a night, I think, you know, at last count. And so I started going through that. And as the year went through, and then we started at River of Life, we started some support groups, which really we felt really led to do. We started a 12-step program on Tuesday night. And in fact, Lauren is leading that. She's going to be sharing tomorrow testimony about that ministry. We started a grief share program and just trying to help people, because we realized that we have problems and we need help. And I was going through my problems. And then Patricia and Perry went through something. Patricia's going to be one of our speakers tomorrow. Perry had an infection from a surgery, and it just was an extended illness. And I started looking around, and it just looked like healing was the thing. And I started doing a word search on healing. And I started looking in the scripture, and I found one of the first scriptures I found was the scripture that said, and Jesus went about doing good and healing all that he touched. And I started looking at that and looking at the word healing. And then I did a search on the Spotify. It's just a music site that you can go to any song you want. And I put in healing. And this song came up called The Healing Has Begun. And I listened to that song, and it just hit me like, that's what it is. I like that. It's not about, you know, it's a fact. The healing has begun. Because healing is a process most of the time. You know, we want instant, but it's a process. And there was one line in the song that really touched me and really summed up what I want to speak about tonight. And that was, it said, in the song it said, don't be afraid to show your beautiful scars, because they're the proof. Yes, you're the proof. The healing has begun. And I started thinking about scars. And it said, don't be afraid to show them those beautiful scars. And scars, you know, aren't really a nice thing. We don't really like scars. They're permanent, for one thing. You know, we don't like permanent. We want something to take it away. Men like scars. Men will show you their scars. I mean, Bobby has an appendix scar. He'll show you anytime. No, I'm just kidding. Bobby won't. But I know where it is. But anyway. You know, men like scars, and they're like really fond of them, but we're not really that fond of them. And we don't really like them, and we like to hide them. But I want to tell you that scars are beautiful. And I know you're asking this question, how can an ugly scar be beautiful? And I'm going to tell you why. Because the alternative is an open wound. Because if it's not a scar, it's a wound. And that's not pretty. So there's nothing beautiful about a wound, but there's something beautiful about a scar, and that is that it's healed.
Amen.
Right? Yeah. And so that is what makes a scar beautiful. So now you can wear your scars beautifully and be proud of those scars, wherever they are. And so, but scars, wounds that are not healed, or not, they're not beautiful because they're nasty. In fact, really the only wounds that I like to, I don't want to fool with anybody's wounds, but I will take care of my kids' Bobos. And you would too. I mean, you know, moms, we just have that natural instinct. We'll just take care of them, and the blood, it doesn't matter, because, you know, that's our blood. That's our kids, you know. Right. And we're like that with our husbands for the most part, and they're like that with us for the most part. But we really don't like Bobos. That's why we put bandages on them, because they're nasty. They ooze, and they're full of infection, and they're just not pretty to look at. But I thought about that, and, you know, that's why we put Band-Aids, because for one thing, the Band-Aids keep the Bobo from getting anything in, and then also the Band-Aid keeps anything from getting out. You see, there's a twofold purpose. Yeah. And for the nurses in here, you know that if you don't take care of Bobos, you will die. You know that, right? There's people in remote places that don't have the right, they die from little Bobos. And so wounds are not a good thing, but scars can be beautiful. And I think about all of life's wounds and how we've gone through life, and we've all had them. In fact, when you have a scar, what, for whatever reason, whatever it is, it makes you more compassionate on someone that's had the same thing. I had 3 C-sections, so when I found out a little mommy is having an emergency C-section, I can say, oh, it's okay, really, it's no problem. You know, because I've been through it, right? Because I know when they told me I had to have a C-section, Mom, you told me that. You said, hey, I've had both. It's much better. Didn't you tell me that? So it's good. A lot of times those things that we go through make us more compassionate on those that are going through them. So there's a lot about that we need to think about. And this is the thing. With the same compassion that we have for people that are going through problems, it was Jesus had that compassion. In Hebrews 2:17, I think there's a slide, says, therefore in all things, and I like this, in all things, say that, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren. He was made like us. And it says that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. That's just to be a substitute. Aren't you glad that Jesus was your substitute, that you didn't have to go? For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. I'm so glad tonight that I have a merciful God who knows my struggles, who's had the same struggles as I've had, the same wounds that I've had. You see, Jesus, he understood rejection. He understood physical pain. He understood emotional pain. I know you're thinking, well, Jesus, but yes, he did. That's why the passage says, in order for him to be that merciful and faithful Savior, he had to endure some things that we endured. All things, it said, he had to endure. And so those wounds that we have in life, those situations that cause those wounds, you know what? God uses them to make us more compassionate and more faithful and helpful. And it says in Psalm that he, in Psalm 147:3, he heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. I thought about the Good Samaritan. There's not very many Good Samaritans left in the world, are there? Imagine him. He didn't know that guy. He probably didn't even like that he was a Samaritan. But he had compassion on him. Maybe that good Samaritan, well, he wasn't a Samaritan, the Jew, maybe he saw him and he says, you know what, I've been there. I've been there. And I'm going to help him because I've been there. That's what's going to make us help people. But you know what? The problem is we don't want the scars because we don't want to be wounded. We don't want to go through that. Nobody really likes to do that. But you know what? We have to. And those scars, just like the scars of Jesus Christ, those beautiful scars in his hands and his feet and his side, those scars tell the gospel story. They tell the story. And those scars in your life, they tell the story. And you've got a story to tell. And so don't be afraid to show your beautiful scars because they're the proof. You're the proof the healing has begun. And I love that. Man, we're going to have to sing that song, although we didn't practice it. I don't really know why, but we're going to play it tomorrow. But I want to say this statement. Unhealed wounds of the heart lead to dysfunctional lifestyles and dysfunctional relationships. You see, tonight, obviously you don't have any bobos that are, maybe you might have a few that are under a Band-Aid, probably not. I'm not talking about those kind of scars, wounds. I'm talking about those ones in the heart. They're the ones that hurt us so desperately. And if we don't allow those wounds to be healed, we're going to live dysfunctionally in life. And we're going to have dysfunctional relationships. And so I thought about these wounds and how they come about. And I came up with 4 ways, 4 categories that these wounds will fall into. And the first one is life inflicted. And you know, I thought about this old song, the old Frank Sinatra song. I'm not really a fan, but it is a kind of a good song, and it says, that's life, that's life. Y'all remember that song? Na 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 na. Mom probably knew it. And he goes, you're riding high in April, shot down in May. That's life. But then for you that don't know who Frank Sinatra is, there's Kelly Clarkson. You might could go, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, right? Y'all know that one? That's life. You know, a lot of times we have problems in life. We're riding high in April, shot down in May, and we're riding, and then all of a sudden that thing hits us, and then we automatically want to blame somebody, don't we?
Yeah.
And it's just life. Who do we blame? Well, it's just the closest person to us. If something happened, it's your husband's fault, or it's your kid's fault, or heaven forbid, it's God's fault. A lot of people just instantly go to God. It's God's fault. Everything's God's fault. Or sometimes, very spiritually, we may say, it was the devil's fault. It was all the devil. And I'm not saying that lightly, because there is a devil, and we're going to talk about that. But you know what? Sometimes just happens. Life happens. For instance, if you have your child in Little League, and he slides into home base and breaks his leg, and you say, oh, that devil, I'm going to say, no. You knew when you put him in Little League, he could break a leg. It just happened. Don't blame it on the devil. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Back in August, how many of y'all remember Hurricane Isaac?
Yeah.
I mean, Sandy tried to overshadow it, but you know what? They don't know anything about hurricanes up there. I need to tell y'all. I was in New York City in the JFK airport talking just like this, and they all laughed. She's from the South. But, and we got on a plane on Sunday night before Sandy hit on Monday. And that airplane took off at 7:15, and they closed the airport at 7 o'clock. We got out on the last plane down south from that hurricane, and look, that was a pretty bad storm, but Isaac was pretty tough. We were without power for about 5 days. But what made Isaac really tough for my family was, if you didn't know this, but my son Robert got really sick on the day Isaac hit. And he and Adriana were staying with us for the hurricane. We were trying to have a hurricane party, but we needed Robert because he's the life of the party, but he was sick. And Adriana came out, and he'd been sleeping all day, and she said, Miss Lally, Robert's really sick, and he had a really bad headache, and he was running fever, and he was sick, nauseated, wasn't eating, and I knew when he wasn't eating, because I've cooked everything in the refrigerator for the hurricane, because, you know, you got to get everything out, cook. But so finally, the hurricane was full on, and they took him to the ER in Gonzales and St. Elizabeth, because we figured he just had a migraine, and they would maybe just give him a shot, send him home, or he maybe just had a virus. And when he got there, they did a spinal tap. Within 10 minutes, they called me and said, Mom, Robert's got meningitis. And so me and Bobby rushed over there, and sure enough, they put him in isolation. We walked in this room. It was very frightening. The nurse was very Nazi-ish, and she said, okay, everybody has to put on a mask right now. In fact, I think you should just all go home. Adriana, am I exaggerating? She said, I think you should just all go home. We'll take good care of your baby. And I looked at her, I said, are you crazy? She said, well, y'all are going to all have to wear a mask, and you have to wear it all the time. And she had this big old mask, not the little paper ones, but the big old cup ones. You couldn't breathe or talk or anything. It covered your whole face. But we all put on masks, and we're all just standing there in this room in paper sheets, and we were just freaking out. I mean, you know, that just really took us off guard. I mean, you know, that I knew people that had children that passed away from that. I mean, that was a really scary time. Did I say, God, why are you letting this happen? I never said that. Because let me tell you something. He was sick for almost a month. And at the end of his sickness, when he was finally getting over it, they called and said it was a mosquito bite. West Nile. That mosquito, he was just minding his own business. He wasn't like the devil flying around ready to... It just happened. Now, this is the big thing. Did God allow it?
Yes.
Yes. Did God get glory from it?
Yes.
So it just happened. You know, sometimes we get scars in life. And look, Robert's still scarred from it, because I asked him the other day, I said, are you over it yet? He said, no, I can't wear a hat. And I said, why? And he said, because my head, it hurts so bad I couldn't wear a hat and I still can't put one on. It just reminds me. So he has scars, but he's good. Y'all saw him. He's good as he can be. And God healed him. He's got some beautiful scars to tell a great testimony of a loving God. And you know, he went through some things. God honored it. God allowed it. But it just happened. And you know, this is the life question, really. Everybody's always curious when something happens, and they always want to say, why? Don't they? You know what? And that's nothing new. The disciples were the same way. In John 9, Jesus and the disciples were walking along the road, and they came upon a blind man, and he was blind from birth. And his disciples said, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. And I think it might be kind of dumb for them to ask, did the man sin? I mean, he was born blind. How could he? He didn't have any choice. Why would you want to blame? But somebody needs to be blamed, right? And so, you know what? I'm just going to tell you right now, sometimes things just happen. And there's no answer for it. That's just life. And God chooses the way he moves and works. But sometimes we just need to say, you know what, that's life. And then there's another type of wound, and it's a self-inflicted wound. There's life-inflicted, and there's self-inflicted. Yeah. And you may say, oh, I definitely know somebody that has self-inflicted wounds. Look at your neighbor and say, I know someone that has self-inflicted wounds. Now say to your neighbor, I know who that is. It's me. Because we all have self-inflicted wounds, don't we? You know, the Bible says it like this. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us have sinned. And you know, there's wages to that sin. And that's why Jesus came. And that's why Jesus died on the cross. And so, really, when you think about those self-inflicted scars, the wages of our sin make those wounds. And you know, those wounds can be healed. But a lot of times, we walk around life with those wounds not being healed. Think about that. Those mistakes that we've made, and yet we've not owned them. And we've not even asked God to forgive us of them. Maybe we just think, oh, if I don't say anything, it's not real. Nope, sorry. Think about David. David, we always use poor David. But David, the king of Israel, and he was the man after God's heart. And he defeated the armies of the Philistines, and then that big old Goliath. He came, that little David, and he came with just a sling and a stone, and he knocked down Goliath, and he killed him dead. But then he became the king, and everybody loved him. They loved David. David was a great king. But then they had battle, and he sent his army out to battle, and he decided to stay home. While he was at home with nothing to do, that's not a good thing. No. You keep those men busy. They don't need any out of time, okay? And he was just kind of idle there up on the top of the castle. And he looked down and he saw Bathsheba and he said, I want her. See, that was the beginning of his problem, but it wasn't the end. See, a lot of times we make bad choices. But what really was the worst part of David's sin was not really the adultery, although adultery is bad. No, don't get me wrong. But David committed adultery with Bathsheba, and then she became pregnant. And instead of owning it and confessing it and repenting and letting the chips kind of fall where they may, because David was way too powerful and he had too much going for him, he just couldn't face the problem, the controversy. And we see that a lot with powerful people. They just can't take the heat, so they just cover it up. And the cover-up is always worse than the sin. The cover-up was eating him alive. And what he did was, when he found out that Bathsheba was pregnant, he sent a messenger out to the front lines, and he said, put her husband out on the front line. So basically, he ordered his execution. So he killed her husband, and then he took Bathsheba. And he just kind of smoothed it over. And you know, a lot of times we think we're going to get away with things. Oh, well, then I didn't get caught with that, did I? That just didn't come out, so I'm just going to go on. Let me tell you something. The person may not know that you offended or you sinned against, but God does. And God will not allow you to continue. The Bible says if you regard iniquity in your heart, God can't hear you. Let me tell you, a man after God. God's heart, he knew when God didn't hear him.
Yeah.
He knew because he was the psalmist. He was the great psalmist of Israel, and he would sing songs and write praise choruses to God. So he knew what the presence of God was.
Right.
Let me tell you, if you can't feel the presence of God, let me tell you something. God didn't move, you did. You walked away from his presence because of sin. But God wants to restore. But David, it says that David, in his sin and in this life-inflicted wound, he brought it all on himself. And it says that David pled for God's mercy. He said, "Oh Lord, do not rebuke me in your wrath." Psalm 38, 1-5. "Nor chasten me in your hot displeasure, for your arrows pierce me deeply and your hand presses me down." Have you ever felt the hand of God on you pressing you down? Come on.
Yeah.
You know you felt it. I don't like it. "There's no soundness," he said, "in my flesh because of your anger. I can't even make sound decisions. I can't even make rational decisions anymore because there's no soundness because of your anger." And he says, "No health in my bones." In other words, his health was deteriorating. Listen, if you have unconfessed sin in your life, your health will deteriorate.
Yeah.
It will kill you. Remember, the wound that's not healed will kill you.
Yes.
It'll kill you in the natural and it'll kill you in the spiritual. So remember that. And he says, "For my iniquities have gone over my head." In other words, he was drowning in his sin. "Like a heavy burden, they're too heavy for me." And then he said, "My wounds are foul and festering because of my foolishness." And David is speaking of the consequences and the wounds of his sin. And he covered it. You know, if David could come back tonight, he would say to you, "You know what? You may have sinned, but don't cover it. Just go ahead and confess it." And also, if you're contemplating something, right now, maybe there's someone in you're contemplating doing something, and you know that it's contrary to this word. You know it's not right. You know your mama said, "Don't do that." And I'm saying that because my mom's on the front row. Listen, when your mama says, "Don't do that," it's mostly there's good reason for that.
Yeah.
David's saying, "Look, don't do it. That momentary pleasure is not worth it." David never recovered from that. He was never the great leader that he was before. It's not worth it. That permanent wound, it's not worth the pain. And then he would say, if you've already yielded to it, don't cover it up. Don't try to cover it up. Acknowledge your sin before the Lord. Don't try to hide from God. But I love what God does. God is ready. God healed David. God restored David. I believe David is in heaven. I believe he has an honored position there because God is a God of forgiveness
right.
and long-suffering. And it says in Psalm 40, David said, "I waited for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit." How many of you have been in a horrible pit?
Oh, yeah.
"Out of the miry clay, set my feet upon a rock, and established my steps." Praise the Lord. Those festering wounds that can't heal. This is a place where emotional and social dysfunctions become inevitable. That's what happens. If you don't let that wound get healed, if you don't let God heal that wound, if you don't uncover it and repent of it and let God begin to heal that thing, that festering wound will bring emotional and social dysfunctions. And inevitably, the cover-up will bring substance abuse. Because, and that's what we see. We're doing this 12-step program, and Lauren's doing a great job. But mostly, it's just a circle of people that are struggling with substance abuse. And they have come to the realization that on their own, they cannot fight it. So they need the support of a group. And probably they're suffering from a lot of emotional scars that haven't been healed. They're trying to cover it up. It's the way of the world now. When you don't deal with your sin, that guilt drives you to self-destruction. Now, I think I have a slide for this statement. And I wrote these things, but I made some statements that I want you to hear. This guilt, this is important, ladies. This guilt will drive a person to feel that they don't deserve anything good. So they sabotage everything in their life that is good, including a relationship with God. That's that is important for us to get tonight. Because if we understand how guilt destroys us, and then we don't feel worthy of anything. So that person that doesn't feel worthy, then they begin to sabotage their own life.
Yeah.
How many of you see that?
Yeah.
You see people do that every day. They have, for instance, a father that maybe has a substance abuse, and he's got good kids, and he pushes them away. He's probably dealing with so much guilt and feels unworthy. And so he sabotages that one good thing in an effort somehow to kind of sacrifice for the sin. But it doesn't help them, and it certainly doesn't help that child. But that's what happens. You know, and a lot of times people will say this, and I've heard it many times, especially being the preacher's wife and being a pastor, people will say, oh, I can't come to church, Sister Lolly, because if I do, the walls will probably, the ceiling's going to probably fall in. Now, in this building, sometimes I wonder, we got a few cracks now, so I'm hoping y'all, the ceiling, if it falls in, it's not you. It's the cracks, okay? The shifting. But a lot of people say, I'm too bad for God. I'm too bad to save. I'm too bad for God to do anything good in my life. So therefore, they go through their life with these festering, unhealed wounds, and they mess up everything in its path. They mess up relationships, lose good jobs, mess up their kids. They isolate themselves, and they just... I'll tell you, it's a sad, sad situation. And so many people are there.
Yeah.
We talk to people all the time. You know what I'm talking about. That are doing just that. But the good news tonight is that they can get over it, and you can get over it.
Amen.
And tonight, the cycle can be broken, and the healing can begin tonight. Those wounds can be healed, leaving only a beautiful scar to remind you that God did it, that God healed you, and that God set your feet upon a rock and established your way. And that's what God wants to do. Many times, those people will die with that. You've had family members die with bitterness and unforgiveness, and a lot of times that will pass on to their descendants, and they'll pick it up. It's like a curse that just keeps on going and going. We're going to break that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You know, Jesus came to deliver us from the curse.
Yeah.
I don't have to be under any curses from my great-grandfather or great-great-grandfather. I don't have to be under any curses, and you don't either.
Right.
You don't have to pick them up, and you don't have to have them if you've been born again.
That's
if
right.
You have Jesus Christ in your life, and you've been forgiven, today the healing can begin and those curses can be lifted. And those things are so demonic in the way they move and work. Think about that. Those people, they're so being led by the enemy. Because really, it's not natural to destroy yourself. It's not natural to destroy your life, to destroy your flesh. People, suicide is on the rise. Bobby said that last week in the message when he was speaking of the decline of America, the moral decline. Suicide is like, does anybody remember that stat? It was like 100%. It's just gone out the roof. That's not normal. The Bible says that we are supposed to nourish and cherish our flesh. Well, we like our flesh. I like my flesh. I don't want nobody coming up and messing with my skin or my flesh or something like that. I mean, I'm nourishing it. I'm taking care of it, putting some lotion on it, Bobos. If I get a Bobo, I'm going to put a Band-Aid, antibiotics on it. I'm going to take care of my flesh. That's fine. That's me. That's my job. I'm going to do that. That's natural. It's not natural, on the other hand, to cut yourself, to harm yourself. That is demonic. We're seeing a lot of that in this younger generation. They just don't know how to vent what's going on spiritually in their life, or deficits in their family, or rejections that they feel. So they act out with physical things, with cutting and a lot of times they'll threaten, I'm going to kill myself. And we need to take those things serious, but as young people, but when they do, and when people take their own life, they leave families to pick up the pieces, and those families a lot of times will take up that same problem, and they won't be healed of it. The third area that we see in those scars, the first, life inflicted, second, self-inflicted, and then third, Satan-inflicted. Now, I'm going to be careful with this one because I haven't arrived here. I don't know everything. I don't know all the answers, but I will tell you that I know where all the answers are. And they're in this book, so if there's ever a question in your mind, don't take my word for it. Just take this word. Pick up this word and read it. But this is what Jesus said. John 10:10, he said, "The thief has come to kill, steal, and to destroy."
Yeah.
That's his only job. In fact, it says the thief doesn't come except to steal, kill, and destroy. So he has in his arsenal nothing good. So when people say, I think I'll just go to hell and just party with the devil. No, he don't care about you. He don't care nothing about you. He don't want to do nothing good for you. He comes except for three things: kill, steal, and destroy. That's all he's planned to do. That's what he's done since the day he was cast out of heaven. And he came and he was given dominion over the earth. And he rules on this earth. And he rules people and he drives people. And his agenda is three things: kill, steal, and to destroy. But Jesus said, "I have come that you may have life and life abundantly." And so that's right. When you think about that scripture, you know that Satan is so busy. He's so busy about this world, trying to keep people from that abundant life. That's his whole goal. That's it. That's all he's trying to do. You know, he's just trying to keep you from abundant life. In Acts 26:18, this is kind of a paraphrase, but it says, and you mark this and read it later, it says Jesus was sent to the world to deliver us from the power of Satan. See, we come into this world with a sin nature. It's just in us, and we just can't do anything about it. But Jesus said, "I've come to give you life abundantly." So when we receive that life through Christ, then we have victory over that power. But until then, we're walking in darkness. We're just as blind as we can be. We're walking in darkness, bumping into everything and everybody. We don't have any clue what life is all about. We haven't found that abundant life, and we're not happy people. And Jesus said, "I can deliver you from that power of Satan." And if we allow him, he'll do just that. So, does that mean that Satan cannot continue to torment us or afflict us? Well, no. I'm sorry. Not exactly. See, Satan can't do anything to us as a child of God. He can't do anything to me that he doesn't first get permission from God. Now, this is getting really kind of heavy, and I don't want to get really heavy into it. But how many of you read the book of Job?
Yeah.
A lot of times when people go through things, they'll read Job. It kind of makes them feel better. Because Job, poor Job, he was a blessed man that said he was righteous and blameless. I mean, if God can say that about you, hey, that's pretty awesome. I don't think he can say that about me. But for Job, the Bible says he was blameless and righteous. And so here's Satan. Now imagine, this is Satan's job. He's roaming about the earth, to and fro, trying to seek who he may destroy. That's what the scripture said. And so he goes to the council of heaven. I don't know what heaven he went to. That's kind of deep for me, but it does say it in Job chapter 1. You need to read it. And he says, God says, not Satan, by the way, God says, "Have you considered my servant Job?"
That's right.
God said it. Mm-hmm. So when people are going through things, a lot of times I'll say, "Have you considered my servant?" Fill in the blank. Because sometimes God will let us go through things so he can say, "Look, my servant, look. She went through all that, and look, she still has both hands lifted." See, Job went through all that, and look, he didn't like it. He didn't like it. He complained. Of course he did. His wife said, "Curse God and die. Come on." But he never did. And God knew it. God knew he wasn't going to curse him. See, God's not going to put that kind of test on you if he's not sure.
That's right.
So see, you're worthy of that test if God can trust you. Now, how many of you are saying, "I don't want to go through what Job went through"? I'm saying, I don't. I'm not asking for it. But I'm just telling you, if you're going through something and you think, "Gosh, this is just like what Job went through," just say, oh, I must be counted worthy.
Amen.
That's what you have to say. And then say, no matter what, Job said, no matter what, I'm still going to bless the Lord. And you know what? God restored to him and gave him everything. And you know, I think that that scripture is there just to remind us. You know, you don't see that. Thank you. You don't see that all the time, often, that Satan inflicted. Most of the time, I think it's mostly just self-inflicted and life-inflicted. But you know what? The devil, he's roaring. He's about. He's trying to get your children. You need to know that. Every time they step on that bus, the devil is trying to draw them in to things. But you cover them with the blood of Jesus. And God's going to have the final word on that. Job never sinned with his lips. And God replaced everything that he had. And he can still say, he never cursed me. So if you know that you've been through something that's kind of on the same level of Job, just say, you know what? I was counted worthy. The fourth thing is, and the last one, and I'm going to close here, is God inflicted. We saw life inflicted, self inflicted, Satan inflicted, now God inflicted. Oh, God inflicted? Really? Well, this is the one I want to talk about. Isaiah 53:10. In your bulletin too, and it's on the screen. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. Talking about Jesus. He hath put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. It pleased the Lord to bruise his son Jesus. So yes, that was God inflicted. But no matter your wound tonight, no matter if it's life inflicted, no matter if it's self inflicted, no matter if it's Satan inflicted, there is only one reason, and that is a God reason. There's always a God reason. There's always a reason why things are happening. There's just a few things, and I'm going to close here. One, to show the works of God. When we go through something, it's going to give God glory. When that blind man opened his eyes and saw, he gave God glory. God used that miracle to start something then when Jesus walked on this earth. And the second thing, to make us a comfort, and we've already talked about that, a comfort to those hurting with the same affliction. 2 Corinthians 1:4 says, who comforts us, talking about the Spirit of God, who comforts us in all tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. So you know that if you're going through a struggle, no matter whether it's life-inflicted or self-inflicted, you can be a comfort to those that are going through the same thing. Because you know what? We just go through the same things, really. Most of us. And then third, to draw people to the fullness of God. 2 Samuel 22:7 says, in my distress, I called upon the Lord. I cried out to my God, and he heard my voice from his temple, and my cry entered his ear. When we cry out to God, it brings us to a deeper place, a fuller place that we've never been before. And you know what, by the way, if you never had a problem and this was in a song, how would you know God could solve it?
Amen.
What would life be like without problems? Well, I'm sure you'd say, I'd like to try just for a week. But you know what, if you never had any pain, you're not going to have any gain, right? If you never suffered a loss, you wouldn't know that God could comfort you through it, could work through it, could solve that problem for you. You know, and we are pitiful creatures, and we do go through things, and we have pain. But we know that we have a loving God. And he never stops. He never stops working for his glory. And he's drawing us. The psalmist said, I will lift my eyes to the hill from where my help comes from. There's help in the Lord. And he doesn't sleep or slumber ever. He's always there, and we need to draw to that fullness. And I'm going to close with this illustration. There was a man by the name of Milton Green, and he owned a carpet cleaning company back in, I don't know how long, it doesn't even give me the date, but I think it was like in the 60s, I want to say, in Cleveland, Tennessee. He was a good born-again Baptist. Any Baptists in the room? I know we got some Baptists. Good born-again Baptist. There we go. One day he got sick. And he went to the doctor, and the doctor said, you've got an incurable disease. Your veins are rottening, and at any moment they could rupture, and you would bleed internally and die. He was only in his 40s, and he was wondering, you know, he just didn't know, why is this happening? And he was driving home, and he became so depressed. But he remembered reading something in the Bible about healing. And so he went home, and he began really studying the scriptures about healing. And he found that scripture in James that says, if there's any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church. It's in there. Let them anoint you with oil. By the way, we have some anointing oil. And look, we believe in that because that's what the word says. It's not because we like it. We do like it. It smells good, but that's not the point. The point is that James said in the Holy Scripture, he says, if there's any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church. Let them pray the prayer of faith. Anoint them with oil, and they shall be healed. He read that, and he thought, well, I'm going to see my pastor. So he went to his pastor. He said, Pastor, I want you to call all the elders. I want you to get some oil, and I want you to anoint with oil and pray the prayer of faith. And the pastor said, we just don't believe like that. And he went away so discouraged. And he didn't know what to do. So he decided to call some of his Christian friends. And he had a big boat. Probably rich. I don't know. But he had a big boat. He called all his friends to his boat. He had a meal for them. And then he called them together. And he said, look, I'm dying. And I want God to heal me. And I believe his word says I can be healed. Will you pray for me? Will you anoint with oil? And they did. They prayed for him and anointed him with oil. And he was healed. And he went back to his doctors. And he said to his doctor. His doctor said, wow, man, you're healed. Your arteries are just completely brand new. He said, I know I'm healed. I just needed confirmation. So he was completely healed. And then he decided, you know, if my pastor didn't believe that way, well, maybe he doesn't believe other ways. And so he started studying the scripture. Through this process, he became closer to God. He began to draw to God, and the Holy Spirit began to draw him. And he saw where the Holy Spirit wanted to fill him. And he got baptized in the Holy Ghost. And he got full of the Holy Ghost. And then all of a sudden, he started getting invitations to preach. This guy, this little carpet cleaning business, he started getting invitations to preach. And he preached a revival at a First Baptist church in Jeffersonville, Indiana. He was asked to testify, actually, and revival broke out. In fact, we prayed tonight. We were praying revival would break out in this place. And I believe it could. Revival broke out, and for 3 months, revival broke out in that church. And he began getting invitations all over, and he started traveling. And then he went to Texas. He was invited to Texas, and he went to a meeting, and he met this young evangelist, and he prayed for him. And he was instantly, this evangelist was instantly delivered from a spirit of lust. And he was just so happy because he had this problem, and yet God had this call in his life, but he had this lust in his heart. And he was instantly delivered. And he went to this guy and he said, man, I want more. And he was baptized in the Holy Ghost. And that evangelist's name, James Robinson. I mean, have you heard of James Robinson? All because Milton Green, little carpet cleaning business, decided that he was going to believe the word of God for his healing. And God used that to draw him to a deeper place. And that's what God will do. God will use those tribulations to draw us to a deeper place. And until we get to that place, we're not going to ever be deep. Because we're going to take those situations and we're going to be like, I just don't want to deal with this. Instead of saying, God, what are you doing? I'm sure Robert asked Adrian. I'm sure Robert asked God over, what are you doing here, God? But he said afterwards, he said, I know what God was doing in my heart. And he testified about that. And I know that because God moved him to a deeper place. And his preaching's different. He's since then God ordained. And so God is using him. Listen, it doesn't matter what you're going through tonight. We've all gone through something.
Right.
But if you have unhealed wounds tonight, you need to get those things taken care of. And God is here. He's ready. The healing can begin in your life. And this last thing, the last point when we go through these things is that we find that it glorifies God.
Yeah.
See, everything we do is to glorify God. Right? Everything we're doing in this place is not to bring glory to one person, to this church, to the pastor, to me, to the band, whatever. It's not about that. It's about bringing glory to God. See, we do a conference every year to bring glory to God, to draw people to a deeper place with Him. And that's what He wants to do in this place. He wants to draw you to a deeper place, and we want to give him glory. Whitney's coming. We're going to share in the invitation. And one story, the lame man at the gate, the beautiful gate in Acts chapter 3. He was there at the gate, and Peter and John came by, and he was lame. And he asked him for gold, silver, whatever. Peter said, "Well, I don't have any gold or silver, but what I do have, I give to you. Rise and walk." Yeah. And that miracle, and we've talked about miracles tonight, that miracle sparked a revival in the early church. It was just what God needed to bring about this move of the Holy Ghost in the book of Acts in the early church. He used that notable miracle. How do you know tonight that what you're going through is not going to be something that just catapults you in to this great move of God?
Yeah.
Well, the fact is you don't know that.
Right.
But if you want to say, "God, whatever you're doing in my life, my family's life, I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready for it to bring glory to your name. I'm ready for it to start something, to start some work. I'm just ready for you to bring me deeper to you." How many of you are ready for that tonight? Would you stand to your feet? Tell the story of what you've done in their life. God, I pray the healing begin right now in this place. And let it start here with me. God, if there's any unhealed wounds in my life, God, I ask you to reveal them to me. Lord, I don't want to carry that unforgiveness or bitterness or anything that keeps me from your presence. Father, I pray that you give us freedom and liberty to experience what you want to do in this place. I cast down fear. I cast down worry and anxiety. I cast unbelief out of here. And I ask you to just send forth your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we say to our unbelief, help our unbelief, Lord. We want to believe tonight for your healing. So, Father, just move in this place, Lord. We give you total control. Say that. Say, "Jesus, I give you control. I give you control. Whatever you want to do in my life, do that work in my life. I trust you, Jesus." Thank you, Lord. We're just going to have a moment, and we want to give you an opportunity to respond, not for any other reason, but just to let your healing begin. Maybe you want to come down here at this altar and just seal it. Just say, "Lord, I'm bowing my heart to you. I'm bowing my life to you, and I want your healing." Maybe you want prayer. We're going to have some prayer counselors available to pray for you and just move in your life. Whitney's going to minister this song.